Okay, so just to kick off, my name is Laura Hyam. I'm the chair of this evening's session. It's an absolute privilege to be here with you all tonight. I'm the founder and coordinator of a relatively new initiative called Vet Sustain. We are a collective of veterinary professionals, mainly from the UK, that are passionate about sustainability and about the veterinary profession, the veterinary profession's role in driving sustainability, both through our own work and also in the sectors that we influence. And of course, that includes the farming sector. We've got a number of really passionate speakers tonight that have worked in agriculture for many years and together have decades of experience without revealing their ages. And so hopefully tonight will be a really fruitful and interesting session to talk about the role of vets and how we can support the farming community in a regenerative transition. So I'm going to talk through a few biographies, just bear with. We've got three speakers tonight, the first one being Alex Tomlinson. Alex qualified as a vet in 1992, and with a background in clinical veterinary practice, Alex went on to specialise in wildlife health, working on conservation projects with Wildlife Vets International, most notably the Vincent Wildlife Trust Pine Marten Recovery Project. During this time, Alex developed a keen interest in the pivotal roles that land management and farming practices have on the health of wildlife and the wider ecosystem. Alex now works predominantly on regenerative food systems and land management with roles in several organisations, including Centralpa, Wilderculture and FLI Farms. Alex is the current chair of the Food and Farming Working Group at Vet Sustain. Our last speaker tonight is Rob, so apologies I'm doing this in a slightly odd order. Rob graduated from Bristol in 2006 with a keen interest in vetting, farming, wildlife conservation and planetary health. He passionately believes that farming is and can be the solution, not the problem, of some of the world's greatest issues. In 2008, Rob founded a farm-only veterinary practice in Lancashire, which is now part of a group of vet practices called Vet Partners, and they look after a third of the UK's dairy cows. Rob has been driving progressive farm veterinary services for 10 years, and many of which have been rolled out across the Vet Partners group. In the last 2 years, Rob has pushed the principles of regenerative agriculture to drive interest within the practices, vets, client base and beyond. These include integrated parasite control planning, soil health monitoring, dung beetle and farm bird surveys, biodiversity action plans and maximising farm subsidy based and private revenue streams in conjunction with other groups like the Woodlands and River Trusts. He's been successful in going through some of the rounds of the Shake Climate Change Challenge with an idea based around the vet's role in regenerative agriculture and specifically to do with the beneficials, the dung beetle being the principal focus. He also sits on the Food and Farming Working Group of Vet Sustain, the Vet Partners Net Zero Farming Group, and still leading the vet practice in Lancashire. So he's a very busy chap. And our very first speaker tonight is Dr. Simon Doherty. So before he takes the stage, a quick introduction. Simon is a past president of the British Veterinary Association and holds a senior position at the Institute of Global Food Security at the Queen's University in Belfast. He was previously the Animal Sciences and Aquaculture Specialist for the Department of International Trade and was appointed as a Global Scot by the Office of the First Minister of Scotland in 2018. He has 2 decades of experience in veterinary practice, industry and academia. He's a certified aquaculture vet and a fellow of both the Royal Society of Biology and the Royal College of Veterinary Surgeons. Simon is BVA representative to the Federation of Veterinary Surgeons of Europe and chairs the FVE Food Safety and Sustainability Working Group. He's a life member of the Royal Ulster Agricultural Society, a trustee of the international livestock development charity Send a Cow, and of the BVA Animal Welfare Foundation, and he's also a fellow director of Vet Sustain. So we've got some really prominent speakers tonight, so thanks guys for your time this evening. And as chair, I'll just be interjecting between the talks tonight, and I'll be also fielding the odd question to our speakers. So without further ado, thank you so much everyone. Get your questions in the chat box as we go along. Please do introduce yourselves. It'd be lovely to hear who you are, whether we've got primarily vets tonight or vet nurses or farmers or whoever you are, would love to hear from you. And also just a thought as we go through, it'd be really nice to hear how you think the veterinary profession can support a regenerative transition. It'd be really interesting to hear perhaps how your own vet is supporting you to do that or how they could in the future potentially help to shape these relatively new farming practices for you. Thanks very much. Over to you, Simon.
Thanks very much, Laura. And can I just have a quick check that everybody can hear me okay? Yeah. Okay. So look, I'm just over the next sort of 5 to 10 minutes, I'm just going to provide a bit of a background to Vet Sustain and how we came about and what we hope to really achieve over the next while. I suppose Laura pulled together a group of us in about October last year, so pre-COVID, if we can remember those days, and really we were looking at various kind of interests around sustainability, and I suppose I would say at the outset that although the people that are here tonight have a particular interest in farm animal and livestock sustainability, Vet Sustain is very much across the profession, and we've got a number of interested parties who are government vets, we have small animal vets, we have equine vets, and zoo vets as well as people working with in various roles around wildlife, and obviously in farm animals as well. We're the first organisation dedicated to supporting veterinary professionals to become a leading force for sustainability. And you'll heard sort of in a little bit of my background that, you know, I've spent quite a bit of time over the last few years working with the British Veterinary Association as an officer. And I suppose we very much kind of see BVA as being the leading advocacy group, I suppose, for the profession as a whole. But Vet Sustain in driving sustainability aims to provide resources and information and be a route of communication to the profession around sustainability. At the minute, we are really a sort of interest group, but we are hoping to register over the next short space and time as a community interest company. And I think the really important thing about where we are just now is the type of people that we can involve in our network. You know, through my roles in FVE, you know, I've got links into Europe. We've got a network of vets who are working with a bunch of really progressive farmers really right across the UK. But we've very much kind of looked to bring these additional people on board. So we've got a certainly, you know, really well, all four of the CVOs certainly have an interest in our work, but particularly Christine and Christiane that you can see there have been particularly engaged in the early stages. We've got Lord Trees, the only vet in the House of Lords, and we've also then got Neil Hudson, who's the only vet in the House of Commons. And we've got them engaged as well, because obviously, you know, there is a lot of political change, some of it linked to EU exit, but some of it was going to happen anyway. So a lot going on around the agriculture bill in particular. And that's sort of been bounced around between the houses. And there's aspects of that very much linked to sustainability and responsible land management. But I think in terms of getting, you know, increased buy-in across the profession and looking at how the profession can work both with small animal and farm animal owners, having people like Jess French and Jen Gale and Cal Major who can really sort of help to be ambassadors in the public sense. So while we're not sort of necessarily going out and campaigning to any great extent, there is a need for us to have advocacy within the profession and create those links between our animal owning clients and the profession. And certainly we very much kind of welcome the engagement that we have through these people as well, because it really helps to cement that link and where we're trying to go to. So like this is, I suppose, this is the doom and gloom slide, but this is why we're all here. You know, the big issues that we're looking at, you know, are around, you know, climate change and, you know, the ecological disaster. We're looking at extinction rates and in particular, those extinctions that are linked to anthropogenic change and anthropogenic behavior. You know, we're sitting here in the middle of you know, a COVID outbreak, and we know that so many of the new and emerging diseases of humans are zoonotic and the likelihood of spillover events and so on from that perspective. So that piece around, and quite often when I'm talking about sustainability, you know, people will say, well, what's the difference between sustainability and One Health? Well, you know, sustainability is a quite a broad concept. I very much see One Health as almost kind of how we get there. One Health, true One Health, is about transdisciplinary collaboration. And what we're here to talk about tonight is largely about collaboration between farmer and vet and nutritionalist and foot trimmer and other specialists that are involved and other consultants that are involved, maybe around biodiversity and around nutrition. Looking at the microbiome and you know, in terms of gas emissions from ruminants and so on. So it's bringing all of those people together to make good progress. Been warned, you know, certainly there's a lot of focus at the minute on antimicrobial resistance. And I mean, even just to take that on to the next stage, some of what Rob will be talking about later on is not just antibiotics, but also then things like anthelmintics and how we use anthelmintics as an important part of that as well. And at the end of the day, you know, when we talk about well-being and sustainability, there is very much an animal health and animal welfare stream running right through that. So particularly as we're talking about things at the minute like international trade deals, the public have a huge interest in the sustainability of high welfare systems. And clearly our agricultural community also have an interest in that particular space as well. We took a look at the sustainability goals, the sustainability development goals that were produced by the United Nations. And what we wanted to try and do was harness that kind of concept. And these are our six veterinary sustainability goals. So this is kind of where we touch around the environment and around the human aspects and so on as well. And you know, things like health and happiness is not just about the health and happiness of you know, the animals that we're working with, but it's about the health and happiness of our clients and health and happiness even within our own profession. Certainly we are a profession that's going through a lot of change at the minute. You know, we need to make sure that we're safeguarding our own health and happiness as well. But you can see there that these are the sort of touch points that we're looking at in terms of giving some direction to Vet Sustain going forwards. We're very much sort of looking then at building how we build our network going forwards and how we can influence you know, the likes of building sustainability into the veterinary curricula at the UK veterinary schools. That's something that we've got with a subgroup working specifically on that. We're looking then at how we can integrate sustainability policy, you know, with the veterinary association. So we're clearly working very closely with the British Veterinary Association, but we've also been carrying out a piece of work recently with the British Cattle Veterinary Association. And we've other interested areas with, for example, the British Small Animal Veterinary Association as well, around the sustainability of pet ownership. So there's a, you know, it is that sort of piece that we're working right across the veterinary profession in the UK. To promote and support integration of sustainability into practices. And ultimately, this is about action. It's all very well talking about sustainability as this kind of, you know, sort of big fluffy concept. And wouldn't it be great if we could do all these things that would help save the planet? But actually, you know, we want to be able to create change. And some of that is about putting toolkits together to get veterinary practices on board as to what they can do that can make a real difference. And look, like any kind of human behavior change, we want to be able to start with small footsteps, building into bigger footsteps. So the small footsteps can be things like ensuring that all of the clinical waste goes into the correct waste streams. That in itself can have a significant impact on the environmental footprint of a veterinary practice. You know, but right through to things like, you know, can they cover the roof of their practice in solar panels and drive, you know, more sustainable vehicles in the practice and things like that. To equip veterinary professionals and vet-led businesses with the tools to support the uptake of sustainability. And some of that even comes down to the ability to communicate with how we communicate with our clients and with our broader staff as well. And I should point out, you know, certainly in the UK, we talk about the veterinary professions. We talk about veterinary surgeons and obviously then working alongside us, we've got the veterinary nursing profession and we've got a number of veterinary nurses who are very much on board with what we're doing within Vet Sustain as well. So we want to be able to, I mean, obviously setting off on a journey, we want to have some ideas of how we can measure impact. So we're not setting in 5 years' time thinking, well, that was all very nice. You know, we did a couple of nice webinars and we spoke at some nice conferences, but what have we actually done? So we're looking at how we can generate some impact indicators as examples that we can take forward. I'm not going to go through them all, but you can see there that we're building some of that into our strategy just now and into our toolkit so that we can actually measure the effect that we're having. That in itself is then going to help us to get better buy-in going forwards, and hopefully it will be a sort of snowball effect. It is very much about creating those resources and being able to influence the sectors that we work with. And you know, we know that certainly at this point in time, there isn't an organization that is doing anything like what we're doing. And we're getting quite a bit of interest from around the globe, in Australia, in the United States, elsewhere in Europe, and indeed, I think I'm due to speak at the end of this month to the Jamaican Veterinary Medical Association about some of the work that we're doing around One Health and sustainability in the UK as well. So I'm going to wrap it up there and hand over to Laura so that we can maybe get on. But I would certainly invite you. We've got a bit of a presence on social media. If you'd like to join us and learn a bit more about what Vet Sustain is doing and the direction of travel that we're going in, or maybe even just to duck in now and again and see how we're getting on. So we'd very much welcome that. But just for now, I'm happy to take any questions just on what we've covered so far, or maybe you want to hold them till later, Laura.
Thanks, Simon. That's a brilliant introduction. Very well covered. So if anyone's got any questions at all, you're welcome to either put your hand up now or pop them in the chat box just while we transfer over. So Alex, if you could take the screen, if that's possible. And we'll go from there. We've just had a couple of questions in the box, but mainly just people introducing themselves. So welcome John, who is farming in the Lincolnshire Wolds with 200 native Lincoln Red Cross Lincoln Red cows. A few comments there. One from Bill questioning our 5,000 veterinary professionals. So that's our aim. By the end of this year, we've got a little bit of work to do. We currently engage about 2,500 veterinary professionals, mainly in the UK, but broadly across the world as well. I've got a crying baby in the background. Sincere apologies. So if we're good to go, Alex, I'll hand over to you.
Okay, thanks, Laura. Okay, just to check, can everyone hear me and see the screen? Is it looking okay? Great. Okay, so I'm going to dive right in to regenerative food systems. I'm sort of make no apology for going in straight into the world of regen, really. So just to kind of set the scene, what do we mean by regenerative food systems? I think a really key point to get across that's absolutely central to what we do is that the food system to be regenerative has to restore respect and care for humans, animals, and the environment. So if any of those are not suitably cared for, respected, in good health, then the system is not truly regenerative. So that is a sort of primary premise, really, of everything that we're talking about when we talk about regenerative systems. And what we're trying to do with a regenerative system is create or recreate true ecosystem health. And an important point of that is a system in which humans are embedded We don't see humans as external to this. We are part of it, and we are part of the health of the system. We're presently not very good at it, but we are. So the question really, with respect to sort of tying this into to vet sustain, is how do vets fit into this? And I think it's that vets have a role in health and not just disease, and really sort of refocusing some of our efforts on health. And when I say health, I don't just mean the absence of disease, I mean physical and psychological health. So that covers what we traditionally say health and welfare, but essentially it is all about health, be it physical or psychological. So that's just sets the scene. So I'm gonna jump straight in with complexity and the concept of complexity, ecological complexity, and why it is so central. And I think it gives us a very good framework. Part of the one of the challenges of trying to get your head around regenerative food production systems is that this is a set of principles. It's not prescriptive in many instances, and it sort of requires a bit of a mind shift in the way that we look at our, from a vet's perspective, the way we look at our livestock, but from a just a human being's perspective, the way that we look at ourselves and the way we fit into the natural world. So I'm just going to talk a bit about complexity, and it's something that Mother Nature does extremely well, unbelievably well. So if we start with the soil, well, actually not even with the soil, start with bare rock, and the ability of the natural world to go from bare rock through lichens and mosses to create soil, and then from there to build soil biology with microbes, bacteria, fungi, and invertebrates, nematodes, and just build literally from bare rock to soil, I think is quite an incredible process. And that process continues underground, and then it starts to emerge overground as we start to cover the ground, or nature starts to cover the ground, with differing plants, plants that grow at different times of the year. So they have different seasons, so that you're maximizing the amount of ground cover and maximizing the amount of photosynthesis to utilize energy from the sun. And then going, you know, further up, if succession continues, moving up in towards woodland, so you're getting into really sort of serious 3D complexity. And within all of this, you've got now above ground all sorts of terrestrial wildlife coming in, so bats, bees, amphibians, and birds, and then into small mammals and larger mammals, and so it goes on up the trophic levels. And the point about this is really that it is just the most incredible sort of accumulation of life, of buzzing life. But the really key bit for me is not just the amount of life, but the way that it's all connected. So the lines, so I've just really, that's a sort of complex ecological network diagram. What it illustrates really is that how all of these species, between themselves, within their species and between other species, are connected in myriads of different ways. And that might be in predator prey, you know, I eat you, you eat me, or that might be in a sort of mutualistic beneficial way, like bees pollinating plants. There are lots of different ways these interactions can evolve. The other really important point about those interactions is that they are plastic, in the sense that they are continually evolving, continually changing. And that sort of ebb and flow, if you like, creates incredible resilience in a system, because it makes it very bendy. And when things start to change, which they always do, there is, you know, there's room to flex, and animals and species within the complex webs can change their behaviors, can change their interactions. So you start to get a feeling of something quite remarkable going on in this complexity. So that's what Mother Nature does very well. And why does it matter? It matters because in terms of the functionality of our planet, our ecosystem, it means that sunlight energy is optimized. So if you've got a really dense sward, all the ground covered, you've got lots of different plants growing at different times of the year. Some of them are very vegetative in spring. Some of them grow later in the season. You can really lengthen out that period of utilization of the sunlight, which is basically, you know, it's free energy. And then the other important point of this complexity is that it cycles minerals, water, and nutrients much more effectively. And the key behind that is that when things are cycling effectively, it means that they're not being lost, they're not being wasted, and they're all going round in the system and they're being utilized by the different species in the system. And also from a productivity perspective, these sorts of systems are, when you've got complexity there, you've got high productivity. And not only that, you've also got nutrient density because of that more effective nutrient and mineral cycling. The foods within that, and everything is food, if you like, because everything feeds everything else, is nutrient dense, and the whole system is resilient to disturbance. So on the other side of the coin, complexity and what isn't so quite so great is when we get involved, really. So we don't do complexity particularly well, particularly in terms of producing our food, to a certain extent, you know, building our homes and so on. And there are lots of other things that we do very badly, but this we're going to focus on kind of food production at the moment. So one of the things we do is deforestation, to clear land to grow livestock or crops. And obviously when we do that, we are creating massive disturbance to a complex system and causing an awful lot of death of species and, as we know, extinctions left, right and centre. We tend to think also, I sort of put that picture in and I was thinking, yeah, you know, Amazon rainforest and stuff like that. And then I was thinking, do you know what, if you go back to the British Isles, there used to be an awful lot more trees here too. So we are every bit as guilty of a deforestation as what is going on in other parts of the world now. And then a second element of what we do, and this isn't an exhaustive list and it's not meant to be a complete, you know, human bashing event, but I'm hoping to try and illustrate really how we've ended up where we are, is ploughing. And ploughing has obviously brought us great benefits in terms of the crops we've been able to grow and feed humanity and all the rest of it. But what we are learning more and more about now is that when we plough, we create serious disturbance to soil, and you can visually see how we are literally ripping through a whole, you know, biological community of life when we do that. So yeah, it's a damaging thing to do. Another aspect of what we do in terms of growing food is we have tended towards monocultures, and by definition, obviously, a monoculture, particularly if it's then sprayed with herbicides, is not going to be particularly high on the diversity scale. So all of those things that we're doing there are pushing back that ecological succession and simplifying the landscape and reducing the complexity. And then I'm just going to introduce the livestock into the whole thing here. So in essence, what we've kind of done is we've replaced all the sort of large herbivores and so on in the grasslands with our own livestock species in various different ways, which doesn't have to be a bad thing, but a lot of the ways we have done it have not been particularly successful, in the sense that, yeah, okay, they've been successful in the short term, but we're starting to see more and more problems now, potentially with things like, you know, we've bred for you know, the wrong traits. We're not breeding for traits that fit animals into that ecosystem functioning. We're breeding for productivity traits for what we want to take out, which is quite a subtle thing, but has a big impact. And then the picture at the bottom is the ultimate in how not to do things in a regenerative way, and that's a feedlot system where not only are we, you know, not fitting animals into the ecosystem, we're actually feeding, you know, ruminants with grain, which is, you know, not what ruminants eat, and it's so far removed from a complex ecosystem. It's hard to imagine anything actually further removed from a complex, well-functioning ecosystem. So what happens, what sort of problems arise in these sorts of degraded systems? We've already talked about the fact that complexity is lost. So we're going from this sort of highly complex, very in flux all the time, very always shifting and changing, to something that's, you know, quite simple. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to see that that is quite a vulnerable kind of system to have. And so we end up with landscapes that are vulnerable and are fragile. And we start to see soil erosion and water runoff as we lose the sward density and we lose the soil depth. We sort of start to degrade these landscapes even further. And the functionality of the system, we talked earlier about the complexity underpinning the productivity and the functionality. The functionality is therefore compromised, and so that idea of harvesting all the sunlight is much more limited. So for example, we've got a sward here which is, you know, very overgrazed, right down almost to lots of patches of bare ground. So there's not a great deal of photosynthesis going on there. So there's not a lot of sunlight energy being effectively harvested. And that, in line with all the loss of the complexity below the ground in the soil and everything, and loss of complexity above ground, means that that cycling of minerals and nutrients and water doesn't work so well. And one of the things that, and this is where we start to get into maybe a more sort of veterinary area, is something that I feel quite strongly about, is compromising animal health. And this might not mean direct disease, this might just mean suboptimal health in ways that we don't necessarily really understand yet. I always think, when I've been sort of looking at feedlot animals, and, you know, they sort of stand there, they maybe don't look diseased, but I can't believe that they're particularly content and have what they need. So, you know, it's this idea that we're not really doing enough for them, even if they're not really, really sick. So an escalation of the previous slide, really. Once health is compromised, we do end up having to treat for things. So we end up treating with antibiotics, for example, or antiparasitics to prevent disease. So we're doing it, you know, we're doing it with the right intentions at that particular moment in time. But I do think we need to look more closely at the underlying reasons. And when the other side of the coin is that when we've got these systems that are simplified and lost their complexity, and the mineral and nutrient and water cycling is not working effectively, nutrient density of the forage available in the pastures is going to be limited. And we're finding that in order to get productivity up, we're having to supplement. So we're having to supplement the land with chemical fertilizers, we're having to supplementary feed animals, we're having to give them mineral supplements. And I'm not saying that any of those things are bad in themselves, but they are, to my mind, telling us something about a system that is not functioning as well as it could be. And the other thing that starts to happen is that problem species emerge. So as we push back succession, as we simplify landscapes with all of these activities, which are all compounding on top of each other, problem species emerge. So in a grassland, that might be docks. And then our instant reaction to that might be to spray for those docks. And actually, all we're really doing with that is maintaining it in that simplified state. And then the picture of the cow there is to illustrate face wise. So for example, if we haven't got the complexity in the system, something like face flies or other problem species can emerge because they have a niche. If they have a lack of predators or a lack of pathogens or a lack of competitors, then they're going to take advantage of that. And then, as you know, our response to that might well be to use porons to kill the insects, which doesn't only kill the face flies, it kills all the other insects. And the end result of that is a downward spiral, which is where it feels to me like a lot of our landscapes are at the moment. So just sort of, you know, broadening that right out and linking this back to the sort of global issues that we face as a planet, a lot of these things, and I'm not saying at all that everything relates to food systems, but they impact at many different levels. So clearly we've seen that some of our practices reduce biodiversity in both grasslands and animal and wildlife. Climate chaos, we know we are seeing a lot of dangerous climatic events now with flooding and wildfires, and one of the factors that will be underpinning that, not solely, but is, you know, damaged water cycles, damaged nutrient and mineral cycles. We have a double burden of malnutrition, which I think is a massive one really. We have, you know, half the world with not enough to eat and half the world with too much of poor quality food, lacking in nutrient density. So we're facing a real double whammy of nutrition. We have a global crisis of antimicrobial resistance, which has sort of taken a back seat at the moment, thanks to our friend COVID-19, which, as Simon's already talked about, you know, when we start producing food, or we produce food in ways that we put animals in contact, species in contact with each other that wouldn't ordinarily be in contact with each other, we disturb ecosystems, and the, you know, the likelihood of emergence of new pathogens increases. So yeah, we do have a problem. So on a slightly more positive note, how can we address the problems of degenerative food systems? And obviously the opposite of degenerate is regenerate. So we're talking about regeneration. And on the back of all of everything I've just said, one of the underpinning principles for me is about recreating and respecting complexity, which is this combination of biodiversity and connectance. And it is, for me, it's about regenerating and respecting, and not necessarily trying to understand every single relationship in that network, because those relationships are changing so much all the time, and they're so different in every different context, particularly within a, you know, British Isles, where the variety of habitats is so immense. So I'm not talking about trying to, you know, nail it in terms of understanding, but work with the system. And this involves using principles and not prescriptions. So in terms of recreating complexity, this might be about agroforestry, tree planting and integrating trees into our landscapes in a productive way. To create that 3D complexity, it might be silver pasture, so introducing animals into our woodlands, so that they benefit from that 3D complexity as well and add to it. And it might be through grazing management strategies with, for example, tall grass grazing and long rest periods, where we're not, you know, where we're keeping that photosynthetic potential, and we're also making sure that we're recycling all those nutrients and minerals effectively. So principles, not prescriptions. And, you know, taking a bit of a step back and observing and listening, and trying to work out, you know, if problem species do emerge, what are they telling us about the system? Because they're usually telling us something. And looking in more depth at our soils, which is, and I'm sure there's quite a few regenerative practitioners out on this session tonight who are regularly doing soil testing and seeing what's going on under the ground on their farms. So secondly, just thinking about the livestock in these regenerative systems, and thinking about diversity and connectance. So on the one hand, also thinking about, you know, integrating lots of different species into a system, because they all add different things and they all have different roles. One thing I do think is quite important is that we start to think about what animals we should be putting, what breeds we should be putting in what environments, because the whole point of what we're trying to do is not in this regenerative system is not fundamentally about the end product. It's about what that animal can do to regenerate the system, and the product is almost a, you know, it's almost like a bonus. But the real role of the animal is to be involved in the regeneration of the system. So, you know, that might be, yes, that might be native breeds, but that might also be selection within your own herds of the most resilient animals, the ones that cope with the system the best, those kind of ideas. Okay, so just to wrap it all up, a regenerative approach, what's the role of the vet? So I said at the beginning, how do vets fit into this? I think vets have a role in health and really, really maximizing and trying to understand what is, you know, true health. It's quite easy to measure disease, but it's not so easy to measure health. I think we need to think like that. I do think there are two key areas for the profession. And this first one relates to the idea that we have a role to care beyond the animals that are directly under our care, I think. So this relates to how food systems impact human, animal and environmental health. We are in a position to understand that and to educate ourselves about that and to use that understanding to drive improvements in food production practices and also drive better decision making by both consumers and producers, really. And just say also, I might have mentioned earlier, but we're not restricting this to terrestrial agriculture. You know, this goes right into the marine and estuarine environments as well, because obviously it's one planet and the sea and the land are intimately connected. And the second key thing I think is that, you know, I might be wrong, they might not, but I think that regenerative farmers want vets. And they want vets who understand the systems in which their animals are being reared. Change is happening. There's a fantastic momentum now behind regenerative systems, several of whom are on the session tonight. And it's absolutely so heartening to see this happening. So as a profession, you know, let's be ready and be able to support it. Okay, that's me done. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Alex. That was a brilliant talk. And I think it was absolutely necessary to go into the meat of the matter with regenerative and how you see it and how you see vets fitting into the picture as well. We've had some brilliant comments on the chat box. So thank you. We've had lots of introductions from people with some fantastic experience, and we've got ecologists turned farmers and a variety of other farmers in sort of organic and conservation grazing and other systems. So really good to have such a great audience tonight. I asked a question about where people think their vets fit in their systems and their production systems, particularly when it comes to regenerative and conservation agriculture. We've got a mixed response, really. Some feel their vets are really open-minded to some of these newish practices, and others feel like the vets could perhaps be much more engaged, and some of them that feel they don't really understand the livestock under their feet, so to speak. So I think we've got a bit of work to do at Vet Sustain to try and upskill some of our profession on this important subject. We had a question. Let's have a look. We've got one comment there, Alex, that John likes the thought that the product is the bonus, which is really nice. We had a question a bit further up. I might have to come back to it in a minute. We've got a really long chat box now, so keep them coming anyway. Really good comments there. And if we could just switch over, Rob, to the next presentation, that would be fab.
Sure.
Thank you, that's brilliant. Rob's got a few awesome videos, so stay awake for those. and we'll pass over. But yeah, as I say, keep the the comments come in, and I'll make sure I field these at the end of the session. Thanks, Rob.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks, everyone. Evening. My name's Rob. I'm a coalface vet, still getting my hands dirty and trying to run a busy farm practice in the Northwest. It's great to hear the Alex talk just then. I'm really here to speak about sort of the practical, what can a practitioner, farm vet be doing? And I've worked really hard to try and come up with what I thought or could be the ways in to try and become more sustainable in what we do, and even regenerative if possible, and trying to roll these out now across the practice. I found that Vet Sustain has really helped. You know, it's a really good support, and any vets, I think there are some vets in the audience, you know, connect up, and by no means have I got all the answers. I'm only going to talk about what, you know, the sorts of things I've tried. I'm very interested to hear everyone in the audience view, farmers and vets and ecologists. It's a really good forum. One of the things we've done at the practice is started through the lockdown, really, an online, what we've called regenerative ruminating, sort of a bit of a regenerative agricultural forum. We've only had one meeting so far, we've got another one upcoming. That's just for our clients. So I'm really keen to hear everyone's views and take this as a big opportunity. So for me, the entry point for us farm vets that's been quite useful has been parasite control planning. So Alex alluded to the complexity and also anthelmintics and the effect they can have. For me, at the moment, we've got a sort of continuum between degenerative practices through to sustainable practices. And then if we can get to regenerative practices, fantastic. At the moment, you know, one of the reasons I've picked this subject is because there's quite a lot of degenerative practices happening. The use of broad spectrum endectocides is quite prevalent. And you know, I've been guilty through my career of not really being involved in parasite control too much. A lot of my farms that I've worked with over the years will go elsewhere to buy products, and I haven't, you know, we're all busy, and if something's not broken, why try and fix it is a sort of classic pitfall we fall into. But I suppose I've been awakened to the fact that maybe there are problems in this area. The other reason is that it opens up a whole world beyond just parasite control, which I'll go into. So sort of step one, it's taken quite a lot of work, but between us, we've developed a toolkit, if you like. So a questionnaire to go and find out from our farms, what is currently happening? What do you do? And it's interesting. Sometimes the same thing has been done year on year for 20 years. No matter what product that is, that's not good for resistance, is it? So finding out then as well about the fields, the numbers of cattle, the stocking densities, the system, it takes quite a lot of time. But having the structural resources there to help our team deliver is really important. But even more critical, I think, what's been absolutely key is finding ways to motivate and engage not only the vets, but our vet techs, and then obviously our clients as well, the farmers, of really getting involved and looking at this and whether we should be changing what we do. It's sometimes, I think, fair to say, people can correct me, but parasitology is not always seen as very exciting. So, it's been great to find something to sort of galvanize the team and embrace a common goal. And for me, that's a really useful sort of key species here is the dung beetle. And I'm not sure if any of you in the audience tonight were on the webinar done, Bruce Thompson, Sally Ann Spence, Ali Burkett, and some others, I think. Really, really good. So I urge you to go back and find the recording of that and watch it. Some great videos. So I'm not going to go into a whole load of information about dung beetles, but I will say a study was done in 2015. Sarah Bainan worked out that the value dung beetles alone bring to the UK cattle industry every year is £367 million just in the UK. So they're phenomenal little guys, and I will just basically, you know, this slide just shows some of the diversity. Again, going back to Alex's points about complexity, functional assemblages, and how it all of these little guys do the same thing. They get rid of dung, they bury it, or they eat it, but they do it in different ways. So having a variety on the farm is really important, as well as having a lot of numbers as well. So this year, I've run a bit of a pilot, something like 20 farms, mostly dairies, some beef, and sort of gone in and found out what people are doing. And roughly, it's really common for macros, MLs, so the clear, poron, ivermectin type wormers to be being used. Something like 80% of the farms engaged were using those. And they are their product that will kill not only dung beetles, but a lot of, you know, most insects. So that's kind of like the, you know, 0, 8, 13 pattern, ivermectin porons a few times a season. And then when they come in the stock in the autumn, they'll get a flucicide treatment as well. And in this case, another poron, which also contained ivermectin. So I get why this is common. It's very simple. It's really easy. Poron, you can't really get much easier than that. And it's definitely perceived as low risk. So if we repeatedly use wormers through the season, we're not going to lose animals to lungworm. We're not going to have low growth rates because of gutworms. So it's perceived as low risk from that point of view. And then low cost as well. Like bottles of the porons are very cheap, really. And I think people tend to buy them and not, you know, it's considered to not be a big cost. It's one of the things in this pilot that we're trying to look at is what does it cost a, you know, an average farm in our practice. This one was something like £900 a year, which is quite considerable. So the key next step is to explain perhaps some of the things that aren't the first things that any of us think of. Some of these were new to me. You know, so if a farm has been using the same product year on year, we're asking for resistance to be built up. And I, one of the questions I've got for everyone in the audience is what value might you place on avoiding the potential for resistance to be developed on your farm? Because I don't have a figure. And then obviously there's the potential for unnecessary treatments. And so that £900 spend, a lot of the farms we've managed to not use any wormer through the, only two were not using any wormer through the season whilst they're grazing. And I haven't got exact numbers, but a lot have managed to go the whole season with testing and not actually need to worm them. The third point, there's some interesting work come out from France in the last few months, which shows TEC is the time of effective contact between the animal and its parasite. And they need that to develop immunity. So if we knock out all the parasites with a persistent wormer like ivermectin repeatedly, then that animal growing up is never going to develop the immunity. And so what is happening, we do see this quite regularly, is, for example, lungworm in adult stock when they're producing milk. And this work from France is looking really at the abomasitis, so the inflammation caused by gut worms that do the damage when the animal's in production. And that, for me, is quite an interesting, it's a really interesting productivity problem that I don't think too many of us were really focused on. And then the last point is about, and I think this is new to certainly most of the vets and farmers I've spoken to, I got laughed at quite a lot over the years. But, you know, there's a lot of benefit that these other insects are doing for us that we're killing accidentally. So some solutions, and this is really just the sort of veterinary side of it. There is the possibility to use a vaccine to prevent lungworm. And in the cases this year that we've used it, when we're monitoring, so instead of treating, we take worm egg counts, we take fecal samples, and if there's not a certain level, then we don't need to treat. if we go over a certain amount of parasite burden, then yes, there's room to go in and we're going to have to treat, but let's try and avoid the most damaging products, which are going to be the ML group in most cases. And then when this time of year, right now, lots of stock are coming in, we're definitely going to need to, in my region, need to worry about fluke and type 2 ostotagiasis. So we're currently collecting lots of muck. But that's just the veterinary side of it. There's also plenty of other strategies, which is where we're now getting perhaps into some of the more regenerative type management solutions. So top left, research from Nottingham has shown the content of browse, willow, for example, contains a lot of zinc, but it also contains condensed tannins, which can reduce the parasite load, the worm egg counts, by I think 30 to 40% if they get enough of it, which arguably most cattle and sheep won't be having access to much. Same applies to herbal lays. So top right image, a lot of the variety of species in there will also contain condensed tannins and do a similar job. Bottom left, mob grazing, allowing the height of the sward to become much, much longer. It really just, and only allowing the cattle to graze the top third, let's say, means that the worms won't be at the point at which their cattle are grazing the plants. And then lastly, you can make use of all sorts of different strategies, including, you know, putting young stock onto silage aftermath. Okay, so this is an image just to sort of summarize some of the areas that dung beetles provide all of that benefit to us, and the soil health and the soil food web. But I won't focus on this because there's a really good, please go and look at the webinar I mentioned. One I will focus on is, so we talked about reduced livestock parasites. One of those is the fly, which I think Alex mentioned earlier. And there's a really interesting little point about flies, which I'll come on to shortly. But the bottom right here, we've got a dung beetle there, and attached to his back leg is a mite, a phoretic mite. And these little guys use the dung beetles as taxis. The dung beetles fly between the cowpats, and they spread these phoretic mites, which basically kill, hunt and destroy larvae and eggs of our nuisance flies. So keep that one in mind. So one of the other reasons that parasite control planning has been a really good entry point, I think, for vets, apart from it being arguably our duty, you know, it's our remit, is we can start to get across some of these concepts, and dung beetles are a fantastic way to do this. So, so I've been conducting surveys on the farms that we're doing this integrated parasite control looking for a number of things. One is, how many different species of dung beetle are there? And second, an estimation at least of their abundance or relative abundance. But not only that, but looking at the diversity of the other dung flora and fauna that's around. And it's been fascinating to see the differences between farms dependent on what they've been using and how they're managing parasite loads. And then also your wider biodiversity observations and obviously comments on the overall findings, which can be fascinating. So here's an example of a pretty good farm with lots of variety. So each bar represents a different species of dung beetle, with the ones on the left, roofer peas, being commonly the most common species we find. So that's a pretty good graph, but I have no baseline yet. I'd like to build that up, but we'll get there. And this is the same thing, but in a sort of form where you actually get to see what those little guys look like and their names. Big guy on the right, Geotrupes. Spinager, they dig huge tunnels, and if you find one of them, they're amazing to watch. So a lot of this is about engagement, the images and things like that. And then this shot, it kind of all of the other stuff, well, there are some dung beetles on there as well, but the wider life that you find when you start looking through cow pats. And I've kind of spent some time with some amazing entomologists, and I kind of grouped the other organisms, if you like, into basically predators that are doing great work for us, and then other insects that are also, like the dung beetles, getting rid of the muck for us as well. So here we go. Here's the beneficial coprophagic life, abundance and biodiversity. So the first two on this farm were absolutely teeming with beetles that look just like dung beetles in many ways. They're a bit faster, and they're actually a totally different genus. And we call them loosely water beetles. They're much faster. And when I first found, it was probably the first beetle I found, the second one in from the left. They're beautiful. They've got gold bums and then red stripes. And I was, that's what I called them, gold bums, for a while, until I found one, because I couldn't find them on the list of dung beetles. And then we've got earthworms, as we were talking about earlier, and other, I mean, the list is endless, but these are just some of the things that I've learned about in the time I've been doing it. So on this farm, the most interesting thing about it, apart from having great variety and abundance of dung beetles, was we also had such an amazing abundance of coprophagic life. I spent quite a lot of time looking around on this day. I found only one maggot for flies, nuisance flies, one maggot. And a lot of other farms, if they've been using porons, that's all I'll find, hundreds, thousands of fly maggots. So it really woke me up to, everything that Alex was talking about, having that, allowing ecology to work for us. The last of these, the last group, is predatory species. So we've talked about the mites, and this farm was absolutely full of them. Every dung beetle was covered in them. But even the yellow dung flies that you'll see, know and love on the pats, little rove beetles, which are long little scuttly things, they just predate everything, I believe. Clown beetles. When I first found one of them, I thought that I'd found a very rare / extinct species of dung beetle. But I was wrong, it was a clown beetle. But they're proper monsters, they eat everything. And then a couple of other flies, so parasitic wasps, which, by the way, we also use to control flies. We've been using those for quite a number of years, but there's also native species that are doing that without us spreading them. So for me, that was fascinating. And as you walk around the fields, searching through cow pats, you'll notice a huge difference between farms where there's a hell of a lot of other wildlife as well. And these guys are taking thousands of flies out of the sky the whole time. So that's a kind of whip through of, if you like, two services we've really engaged with: parasite control, and then on the back of it, basically biodiversity surveys, but dung biodiversity. And that kind of allows, so a lot of the services I've been looking at is, it's not necessarily people looking to go towards mob grazing or anything like that. It's really a lot of dairy farms that it's very difficult to be truly regenerative. So what I'm talking about is more taking people from their first steps on a pathway in a good direction. And a lot of the conversations around what we've just talked about helps then start us thinking of soil health. So we've been using Soil Mentor, which is an app I'd recommend to vets farmers to go and have a look at, check it out, to train ourselves about soil health, because we're vets, we're not experts in soil health, but it's a fascinating and rapidly growing area of science. The ecology of it is, I mean, it's endless, and I think the more is understood, the more we realize we don't understand, but it's very important. And I guess the idea here for our practice with our vet techs is that for those farms who are interested but maybe don't have time, if our vet techs are there anyway, doing other things, disbudding or vaccinating, they can quickly go and do a worm count in the field and record that on the app, and that will build up a bank of data to help engage and drive change, hopefully. Some of the aligned contracts are also asking for things like biodiversity action plans, even planting trees. And I think vets, we do have, once we start having the conversations almost progressively towards soil health, because it does all have an impact on the animals that we're charged to look after's health, then we can start looking to connect up the people we work with on farms with other people who are actually have a whole load of funding that can potentially really help solve problems or plant trees, whether it's silver, you know, if you really want to, one end of the spectrum is silver pasture and agroforestry, but it might just be that your stock in the hot summers could do with a bit of shade from trees. And I'd really recommend anyone to contact the Rivers Trust or the Woodland Trust and have a visit and get your vet involved as well if you want. It's they're really fascinating visits. And then lastly, I wonder whether the farm vet has a role in elms in the future. Maybe we can help bring people together, facilitate, in some cases, maybe look at other potential revenue streams for our customers. Ultimately, a farm vet is totally reliant on a successful farm business. And I think this is probably the way the industry is moving. And it's potentially a really exciting opportunity for farms and actually whole communities. I'm interested to hear everyone's thoughts on that. So that brings me to sort of the end. Thank you for listening. I'm really keen to hear vets and farmers, everyone, their ideas. And this last slide isn't for me to talk about parasite control anymore, but I do have a video that I'm going to share with you, if that's all right. Let's see if we can get this to work. Okay, so this is really just, I've actually been asked to do this for our group to try and encourage others to think about parasite control. So bear with me, see if this works. And I'm going to put myself on mute.
My mission has been to find reasons for farm vets and farmers to get involved with the integrated parasite control planning. There are loads of excellent reasons to do so, but this video focuses on the world that you can step into by engaging with your farm flora and fauna.
Watch out now!
Always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. And always look on the bright side of life. Come on! Life's a piece of shit when you look at it. Life's a laugh and death's a joke, it's true. You'll see it's all a show. Keep 'em laughing as you go. Just remember that the last laugh is on you.
Awesome. Is that you done, Rob?
That is.
Amazing way to finish. They just work so well to music. Like, don't be, who would have thought? They're like, just rock it, don't they? Thank you so much. That was a really lovely finish and a brilliant talk. Really, really rich in information. And yeah, a huge amount has gone into your work and kind of diversifying your traditional veterinary role. It's really interesting to see that journey and to see what you're doing now. So thank you so much. We've had loads of comments and loads of really enthusiastic remarks from our audience on all of our talks. So thank you everybody for jotting those down, and I'm going to go through some questions now. If you've got any questions, carry on typing them in the box, that would be great. And if you've asked a question but would like to ask them on screen and you want to actually say them, please just put your thumb up. I think that's what you can do. You can go on to reactions in the bottom bar and just put your thumb up, and I should be able to see that you'd like to pop your video on and ask your question directly. But otherwise, I'll just start talking through the questions, going back to some early ones. Okay, brilliant. We'll start with Bill's, who asked a while ago, what happens when the system is fully restored? This is probably one for you, Alex. So the concept of regenerative assumes that actually your baseline is already degraded, but what actually if a farm is starting from a pretty good level and they've already restored the ecosystem to a pretty good level? I guess it's questioning the very terminology around regenerative agriculture, but what do we do basically when the system is already pretty well restored? I guess you've achieved your end point, have you, Alex?
Down the pub, I reckon. gosh, I don't know. I mean, I suppose you're in word sense, you're moving towards sustainability, but I think I just think systems are so constantly evolving and changing that, and I do think I think we've got a long way to go before we're, and I guess the other thing would be to move towards landscape scale regeneration, you know, going from one farm to many farms to whole landscape scale, because that's how you really affect change at planetary level, I guess.
Can I just sort of come back to that, Alex? One of the things that maybe worries me a bit is that most people need to see an achievable end in order to start investing in the journey to get there. And it's almost as if they have to sign up to a never-ending struggle to achieve something that in the end might always elude them. But it's probably just me being a bit pedantic. And, you know, the term regenerative seems to be very well established now, and most people who are thinking about those issues will understand, you know, that how it's going to work for them.
Yeah, I know what you mean, Bill, and it can be, yeah. The last thing we want is for a word to be a barrier, because, you know, that's the whole point of all of this is to try and encourage and make things achievable. But you can have small achievements, you know. Everything is an achievement on a regenerative pathway, isn't it? I guess. But I do hear you, and we think a lot about our terminology.
I think it's all like it's a continuum, isn't it? And it's not just farming, it's all of us in our daily lives. Are we doing harm? Are we damaging the planet? Or are we, you know, acting sustainably? Or are we doing something that's helping the environment? And, you know, farming's no different. And no matter where you are on that continuum, just take the next step. So all the stuff I just talked about, actually, I mean, is it regenerative? In a way, but it's basically that first rung. Let's see if we can take what's something that's holding back ecology and remove it and allow some ecology to come back. So in that respect, it's definitely becoming more sustainable. Like you say, words, is it, you know, you can argue about words all day, can't you?
Yeah, that's a really good point. I think I was talking to somebody last night who's a consultant in regenerative and said that she'd used the word holistic in a program in the US, and the program had literally gone nowhere because the word holistic was very, very alienating, certainly in the States, but potentially here too. So yeah, words definitely matter. Thanks, Alex, and thanks, Bill. Move on to the next one from Emily. So Emily was interested in the role of drug manufacturers. This is probably one for you, Rob. And she was alluding to manufacturers possibly needing to take more responsibility in terms of the environmental impact of their products. But more specifically, she was wondering whether porons contain more active ingredients than drenches. Is that one for you, Rob? Could you answer that?
Yeah. Okay, first part of the question, if you read the data sheets on a lot of these products, you'll be surprised at the words that are in there, you know, highly biotoxic, bioaccumulative, sorry, and very toxic, and lots of instructions about not letting animals anywhere near waterways and all this. And I'm not even actually asking for veterinary, making sure it's under veterinary guidance and advice, but it, you know, a lot of these products I've never once sold. So I don't know if that's the manufacturer's responsibility or the VMD or the industry or me as a vet. I guess I'm trying to do what I can. The second part of it is about the concentration of the active ingredients. That's a really good point. Yes, so a lot of the porons have you'll use more active ingredient by using a poron than if you'd use that same active ingredient is an injection, for example, and you'll probably get less splashback directly into the environment as well. So there's certainly merit in you know, selecting products that that aren't porons per se, but it's also the actual active ingredient. So ivermectin is one of the worst in terms of its persistency and in terms of its broad spectrum activity on beneficials. And if we can select much more narrower spectrum of activity, no different to antibiotics really, then we should be doing that if we can. Yeah.
Simon, I don't know if you've got anything to add there to that thread. I think Rob's done a good job of covering most of it.
There is a bit of work going on around, you know, drug delivery systems and making drug delivery systems more affordable and, you know, within the pharmaceutical industry. So the concept of a drug delivery system is, you know, we're not talking about, you know, a man in a van. We're talking about, you know, we're talking about within the bottle, things that can actually reduce the dose of active ingredients that is required, but targeted to the right place. But you know, the problem with drug delivery systems is that they tend to add cost on to, you know, the product and so on. So it's certainly an area that is being looked at, but it's I popped in the box there just a piece around. I think Nikki had asked the question about disbudding, and I'd sort of put a link just in the box just about routine husbandry procedures in calves, so the use of anesthesia and analgesia for calf procedures. But coming back to this aspect, I mean, we're in regular discussion at BVA. We're in regular discussion with NOAA, which is the industry body, the National Office of Animal Health, is, you know, but NOAA is the industry body representing the veterinary pharmaceutical industry, animal health industry in the UK, and we'll be in regular discussion with them about things relating to that as well. There's quite a bit of focus as well, not just in sort of pour on wormers for cattle, but also around spot on products for companion animals as well, because let's face it, you know, a lot of our companion animals are out in the countryside and, you know, in our waterways and things like that, and as Rob's alluded to, you know, some of these products are very, very persistent, and even very small concentrations coming off animals into waterways or into the environment can persist for a very, very long time. So, you know, it is certainly something we've looked at. There's been a huge amount of work done in reducing and replacing and refining the use of antibiotics, but we probably have some way to go in respect to the anthelmintics as well.
Thanks, Simon. And thanks, Rob, for that response. That's great. Hopefully that answers that one. Catherine, as we're on the treatment side of things, would you like to unmute and ask about Fluke?
Yeah, thank you. So we've just moved to a farm in Argyll, and I'm really, just learning everything. So we've just got a small herd of cattle, and the farmers around us say, oh, there's liver Fluke everywhere. Well, they're not Devon, so they won't be saying it like that. I can't do the Scottish accent, won't try. But anyway, so we're riddled with liver Fluke. So I'm the ecologist, and these poor cattle of ours are not going to see any kind of anything. But I am, you know, concerned. So hoping to build up the dung beetles. I think they're, you know, really interested in all of that. I also read an article about ducks, apparently. They seek out the snails. But I just wanted to ask you guys about any other, you know, ways of combating liver Fluke in an alternative way, please.
Who would like to take that one? Do you want to take that one, Simon, or?
Yeah, I mean,
Alex or Rob?
Rob's probably closer to this than I am. I mean, I'm a few years away from farm animal practice now. You know, probably Rob and Alex, but I mean, certainly the issue is around triclobendazole resistance, and then, you know, if we're not going to use triclobendazole, it's how we then deploy the other Fluke products that we have available, and when we use them in cattle, and you know, what the withdrawal periods are, particularly in the dairy herd and things like that. But maybe defer that one to Alex and Rob, maybe just to have a chat about that.
Shall I go? Okay, so my take on the whole Fluke thing is, Fluke's fascinating. And I think where we have Fluke problems, broken water cycle is a massive part of it. Where you've got standing water. So these snails love the interface between water and the land. So if you've got poor drainage, if you've got poached areas, so if you've got supplementary feeding in round bales, if you've got lots of rush pasture, you know, most of the things that are associated with rolled back succession and simplified landscapes favor Fluke. They're one of these one of the winners, if you like, of the simplified landscape thing. So there isn't a quick fix in that sense, because it's all about the whole complexity stuff I was talking about, but I think, and Rob will have more stuff on this in a very practical sense, but you know, fencing around your or creating ponds, or fencing around your poached areas, your wet areas, or that kind of thing, and timing your grazing to avoid the Fluke risk areas. But I'm going to hand over to Rob on that for very hands-on.
Well, Fluke's a nightmare. It's horrible. I think. Yeah, I mean, so the day-to-day in my job, we monitor all our dairy herds, bulk milks, for example, and anyone that grazes, it's high in Northwest. It's, I think what Alex said is true. You know, we're so wet, and I think it's spread a lot, a bit like TB did after the foot and mouth cull, basically. So I think it's spread because of that. I think climate change isn't helping, and it's really tricky. You know, I presume, did you say you were beef or?
Yeah, we're beef, and okay. Basically all that Alex described, we've got, because it was really hyper overgrazed. We've got rush everywhere, water standing. So we're going to plant trees. We'd love to do all natural regeneration, grazing, meadow restoration, all that kind of stuff. So hopefully with time it'll get better. But yeah, anyway, I'll be quiet.
I'll just say, I spoke to a farmer recently, Bruce Thompson, who I hope we're mentioning this, but he said he's not organic, but a dairy herd. And he says, since he's really focused on his dung beetle populations and the consequential increase, a bit like all the biodiversity I was talking about, he says he's really seen a reduction of Fluke as a problem and in his bolt tank since that life has come back. And I guess we don't know, but maybe there's other beetles, ground beetles, eating the free living stages or the snails. Plus, I have no idea, but it would make sense to me.
Thank you.
Does that help, Catherine?
Yeah, I think that's really helpful. What about the ducks then? I read something about ducks. A sheep farmer who had ducks went on, there was free reign with her sheep, no liver fluke, avian flu hit, and then suddenly she had a liver fluke and the farmer next door has had liver fluke.
Go on, Alex. I was just going to say, I think I remember being taught that at uni, but I can't remember ever having like delivered it in practice. So if you've, anyway, if anyone else has used ducks and found them successful, please
French,
do.
I think there's some French work on, I think there's some published French work on using ducks.
Okay.
Perhaps I could just butt in a minute to say that we have a lot of different bits of ground that we graze our cattle on. And the one place where we are absolutely confident that they'll pick up liver fluke is an RSPB reserve that's full of ducks and geese and almost every other kind of bird. But I guess my take on it is that they're keeping a lid on the problem, but they're unlikely to ever remove it altogether.
Yeah.
But the other thing we've noticed is that over time, the cattle actually seem to be coping with it much better. So where we would have had several animals, you know, tested positive for fluke and had to treat them because they got thin, you know, that doesn't seem to happen anymore. So it just, you know, raises the question in my mind of whether they can develop immunity or whether we've somehow managed to breed it into them by selecting the animals that do best on this kind of system.
Yeah, can I just, I think that really raises a really interesting point, Bill, which relates, there was another question on the chat about immunity to parasite burdens as well. And I mean, from the stuff I've read about fluke, the researchers say that there is no evidence of a good, you know, immunity to fluke. I don't know, but the other thing I think that we're missing in this whole piece is the role of animal health in this and animal immune systems and animal immune functioning based on underlying health. And there's some genetic elements to it. There's some epigenetic elements to it where animals can switch on genes based on their environmental surrounds. So I think there's a massive amount in this picture that we really are only just scraping the surface of. And some of the research that's done in laboratory situations, if you like, where you've got cattle in pens and they're being fed rations or whatever, that is very different to cattle out on pastures, you know, to real life situations. So I think, yeah, there's a lot we could learn about this.
Thanks, Alex. Does that help, Bill?
Yeah, yes, it does. And just going on to a slightly different topic, but related to parasites, is, you know, obviously the emissions that these animals are producing are a very contentious and problematic area for livestock farmers, the methane. I've spent a lot of time looking at the evidence for this, and the call is always to increase our efficiency by getting the livestock to grow as quickly as possible. And one of the ways that we can do that is to use more parasiticides to get rid of these things that are slowing down the growth of the animals. But then the negative impact of that on the wider environment. So how do you weigh up these different sides of the coin? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I do. It's actually the first question I ask in my parasite control questionnaire is, what's your current attitude to risk around? It's certainly true. If you use pour on, you're going to get really good growth rates as long as the diet's good and all that in your young stock. But then you're building up other problems that aren't as obvious. You're building up the potential for resistance. You're not allowing the animal to gain immunity. And actually, we see that. And that's what this French work has come out with. Steve has been involved with, which shows if you target, if you're a dairy herd, for example, and you target your lowest producing cows in early lactation that have been overwormed, let's say, and have got a high bulk milk tank value for ostotagia, you target them, you'll get 2 liters. So you'll get a really good response. But that's only if they haven't been allowed to generate immunity as young stock. And that's one of the questions, I didn't come to that slide at the end, but one of the questions I had for people was, what value as a farmer do you place on not getting resistance on, well, we've got the research on dung beetles, but there's plenty of other insects out there that are doing fantastic work for us as well. You know, I haven't got a figure for that. What do you think?
We only treat animals that are showing clinical signs, and then we test first. And so that brings me back to this point about the cattle. So the cattle that we've tested this year, who've gone thin for some reason, came back negative for fluke, whereas other cattle that we've tested in the past have been perfectly fit and fine and just routine tests, but they have been positive for fluke. So there's a mixed messages coming from the testing. I guess now we're much more relaxed about it, and we just let, in a way, nature take its course. And because our system is a fairly kind one, it's not limited by targets for finishing animals. Then, you know, if they take a bit longer to finish, then that doesn't cause us any problems. But I can see that we would easily be subject to some criticism from people who said, well, these animals are taking long to finish, so they're producing much more methane. So that's kind of what the analysis that we're trying to do. You know, maybe there's we should pay more attention to treating animals to get them to grow faster so that they're not hanging around for so long producing methane.
Can I just come in on that? I think there was obviously there's probably quite a few PFLA people on here tonight as well, and there's been some talk about the whole idea of finishing animals more quickly to basically get them off the planet, so they're not belching and farting methane everywhere. But I think the danger with that approach is that it's single issue focused, and we have to, if we're talking about food systems, we have to look at the whole thing, and not just the, you know, I use the phrase carbon centric quite often, but it isn't the only thing that we need to look at when we're evaluating systems. Is how I would view that.
Thanks, Alex. That's great. We're now 5 minutes over running, I think. So I think we'd better start to draw things to a close, but we've still got a load of questions to get through. So I'm just going to ask literally one more before I think we let everyone head off. So the last question that I think would be best to go to Rob, but feel free to interject, Alex and Simon. This one is from Nikki around disbudding. So the non-intervention aspect of regenerative, obviously are quite key, and many would oppose such practices or wish to phase them out. Are there any thoughts about how we might replace these sorts of interventions, and about the sort of intersect between regenerative and some of these considered necessary interventions that we currently do in conventional agriculture? Starting with Rob, maybe?
Just budding? Thank you. I guess there's is that whole what does regenerative mean debate. It would be great if we could breed if we're disbudding animals, if we could breed the same animal but without horns, that would be preferable. I was asked a similar question about vaccination recently, and I don't see that regenerative agriculture would preclude or demand vaccination. The vaccination is a great thing generally, it's an investment, is my belief. But it doesn't really have anything to do with regenerative agriculture. I mean, that's my view. I don't know what you guys think. So disbudding, I do get that. It's an intervention, but is it, you know, I'm opening the floor to you guys.
Simon, is there anything from the recent BVA?
Yeah, so I actually popped a quick response just in the chat box. You know, BVA has done a wee bit of work, you know, recently on use of anaesthesia and analgesia for routine husbandry procedures in calves. So basically disbudding and, you know, castration and dehorning. And that's very much the line that we're, you know, sort of taken from a BVA perspective. But I would agree with Rob. I mean, obviously, if we can head towards a position where, you know, we don't need to do cesareans on Beltex sheep, and we don't need to do, you know, our Belgian blue cows, and we don't need to do, you know, we can finish cattle without having to castrate them, or we can, you know, we can use bloodless, you know, castration, you know, sort of bradizos and things like that, or we can use polled cattle, but rather than horned cattle and things like that. I mean, obviously those are the, you know, that's the direction of travel that we'd love to be able to go in. But I think in the meantime, this is, I suppose, part of what this session was about. You know, I think where there is a conversation to be had about disbudding cattle, it's a conversation that needs to cross between the vet, the farmer, and possibly the vet and others at the abattoir. You know, when you're at that stage, as to how you're going to potentially handle cattle that have horns, or how you're gonna manage it, you know, and the sort of, again, the use of the word holistic, but the holistic system, you know, in terms of the welfare of the animals when they're on farm, the welfare of the animals during transport, the welfare of animals in the lairage and things like that. And sometimes those conversations can be fruitful, and you know, you can be surprised as to what direction that they'll take you in. So I certainly would encourage those conversations to happen, you know, and I think that is how there's possibly ways around this. But yeah, I would direct, you know, sorry, anybody that's interested, I think I popped the link for the BVA sort of policy position on use of anaesthesia and analgesia for routine husbandry procedures in calves. I think I popped it in. But if you go to the BVA website, you'll also find the BVA's position on sustainable animal agriculture as well, which sort of links in with some of the work around farm quality assurance schemes and so on as well. So it's a link, and it sort of mixes into aspects of, you know, livestock health and welfare, some of which we've touched on tonight.
Thanks, Simon. That's great. Anything to add from you there, Alex, before we wrap up? I guess most of it's been covered there. Great. Thanks everyone so much. It's been a real privilege tonight to chair this session. We've had some brilliant conversation in the chat box, and yeah, great engagement this evening. So thank you so much for sticking around until the end and beyond. So that's great. Thanks again to our three speakers, Alex, Rob and Simon. And just a final little plug, if I might, for Vet Sustain. As farmers, I guess you're at the end of the chain in our work, in that we're primarily hoping to advise veterinary professionals to better support their own operations and the sectors that we influence, including farmers. So really what we'd love is if you're interested in our work and you're interested in your own veterinary surgeon getting involved in Vet Sustain, then just give them a nudge and show them our website, which is vetsustain.org. And I've popped my email address in the chat box. We're also on the lookout, it's pretty early days, but we are on the lookout for case studies and kind of hub farms for Vet Sustain going forward, where we could potentially bring together the conversation around regenerative with both farmers and vets, with vets potentially just operating at the fringes of the this discussion at the moment, as evidenced by tonight. We've mainly got a farming audience, which is fantastic, but we'd love to bring more vets into this conversation. So if anybody would like to work with us going forwards to bring vets and farmers together on this really essential topic, then please let me know. So I'm Laura Hyam, and my email address is laura@vetsustain.org. So please feel free to drop me a line. Thank you, everyone. We'll let you go back to your families and a drink, potentially. But yeah, thanks, everybody, for tonight. And we hope to speak to you again soon. Take care, then. I'm guessing, Neil, you will cut us off at some point, is that right, or do we just
I can end it but before I do that, do we know whether we've saved the recording or not?
Yeah, that's a good point.
I've messaged Ellen, but I don't think I haven't heard anything back,
so it's saying I can pause or stop the recording, so, and it's still looking like it's recording in the top left, so I guess I can just stop it now because our conversation is waffling.
To be
I'll
honest,
stop it now.
Yeah.
I was just looking at the speaker notes.